everyone for taking the time to work on your business. And we know everyone out there is busy, of course, not only running their business, but working in their business. And we've got George Sergio here today, a partner at Cogent Growth Partners, who's going to share how you can run your IT business like you're going to sell it. And this topic is pretty near and dear to me myself. I was a solution provider for 20 years and actually sold my business in 2002. And certainly a lot of the tips George is going to share with you, I had to learn on the fly. And without a doubt, running your business like you're going to sell it will certainly maximize your profitability right now, because you're going to be focused on building a fantastic business, perhaps to sell it or do something with it in terms of an exit strategy down the line. So really a good topic for everyone out there running an IT business or managing or some executive type role. So what we're going to cover today, I'll give a brief Autotask overview, and then we'll jump right into George's topic, and he'll share how to run your IT business like you're going to sell it. We do have a couple of special offers as we wrap up today's webinar, and then we'll leave some time at the end for questions and answers. So a little bit about Autotask. I know we've got a lot of Autotask users probably on this webinar right now. Definitely look forward to sharing some current things going on here at Autotask, and also with our special invited guests or non-users. Look to share a little bit about who Autotask is and how we can help you run your business. And number one, Autotask is industry leading. We are the number one provider of cloud-based IT business management software, and we've been doing it since 2001. We're all about service automation. Built right inside Autotask are several key applications, and in fact, we can help you replace at least five different applications in your business, and sometimes more, dependent on how you piece things together. But starting with the Autotask CRM module, you can market to your prospects and clients, build and manage a pipeline, deliver quotes, and then, of course, once you win that project, execute on that project using our project module, and then move right into service desk and support, always collecting time and expense against projects and tickets opened up in your service desk, so you can send out those invoices that are the lifeblood of your organization. And we know we're not alone. Well, we're service-focused. We do partner with various product quoting tools, so you're going to be able to see price and availability live and online from partners like iBiz10, QuoteWorks, Channel Online, all out there doing a fantastic job quoting product and, of course, services, and handing it off inside Autotask so you could manage your pipeline. We also have tons of other integrations, over 125 integrations right now with Autotask and other platforms and applications that you're all out there using every day, all or in part, like a RMM solution to monitor servers and networks and your client devices, and of course your accounting systems. While you're collecting time and expense in Autotask, you can hand off your time and expense or your invoices off to your accounting system like QuickBooks, Great Plains, and of course backup, disaster recovery, and all those key solutions that you're using. We also know you're not alone out there yourself, just like we're not alone. We've got our client portal to help you collaborate better with your clients, deliver better service, take those service requests right from the client portal into your Autotask, and begin to manage the work that you have to execute in order to resolve that incident. TaskFire is our help desk solution for internal IT, a co-managed service desk. You can let those internal IT resources use TaskFire. It's tethered to your Autotask. As they are opening tickets and doing work inside their organization, you're going to have visibility into what's going on. They can also escalate issues to you. It's a great solution to get into larger accounts. Our outsourcing capability built inside Autotask, you can delegate work to your peers and partners out there in the industry. We've got over 50,000 users now in our Autotask community, and they're all online using our community software, trading work and best practices every day. And of course, being hosted in the cloud, software as a service, cloud-based, there are no installations, no fat clients, no servers that you have to install. We are investing 50% of every dollar back into Autotask, and when you need it, we know it has to be there. We are on 4/9 availability, and you know Autotask will be there when you need it. as we are the number one provider of cloud-based IT business management software. We are global, more than 200 employees across the globe. Our headquarters here in East Greenbush, New York, just outside of Albany, and customers in more than 55 countries. We've got data centers in the U.S. and the U.K., and others are going up as we speak. We'll keep you apprised of that. We definitely want our data centers to be close to where you are working and give you the best access possible. We're also open. We say we're open on the front end. You can use any browser you want. Again, as a hosted app, we are browser independent. Any browser you want to use, you can use to access AutoTask. And whether you're an executive, a sales rep, billable resource, non-billable, you can access AutoTask. It is also open in the middle. We're configurable. We do not force a particular way of work up on you. We have a lot of configurable automation workflow rules that let you set up business the way you want to run it. We also do come with some templates so you can get started quickly out of the gate. And we're also open on the back end, as I mentioned, lots of integrations across the different types of solutions that you guys are out there delivering every day, from RMM to BDR, integration with Outlook and Exchange, quoting, managed print and accounting, and a host of other integrations that you can take a look at right off our website. And just a little bit about our automation capability. Not only is AutoTask there for you to help you run your business, but it's there to help you automate and scale. And really, that's the key today, is how do you handle more clients, manage more seats, and it's through automation, and you can optimize your workflows, let things happen automatically. For example, if you are monitoring servers using a product like Enable or Level Platforms or Kaseya, GFI, any of these RMMs, get up an alert. It's going to automatically create a ticket in AutoTask. From the client portal, a ticket is created automatically. An email, create a ticket automatically. And from a user call, in two clicks, you can open a ticket very quickly. And once it's opened, a lot of automation can take place. Notifications out to your clients that you, in fact, received their service request. Notification to engineers of a new ticket. An update on your SLA status. If you have to respond within 2 or 4 hours, AutoTask helps you prioritize your work and shoots out notifications to ensure that you're hitting your service levels that you promised your client. And once, of course, that ticket is complete, you can send out an automated survey and validate the work that your team has done and the satisfaction of your client and stay right on top of that. And, of course, tie in that time and expense to a ticket across multiple different billing relationships you can have with your client, whether it's a managed or recurring service contract flat fee. You still want to track time and expense and tickets against that contract, block hours, retainer time and material, and so on, all to produce invoices or hand those invoices off to your accounting system, and always analyzing profitability. And, of course, George is going to talk a little bit about profitability and how you want to achieve that to sell your business. We're also about education. We know you're going to be pretty busy out there, so we've provided multiple formats of education, from live webinars, on-demand training videos, roadshows, and boot camps. You can get all the education you need through AutoTask Academy and really not only help you understand AutoTask, the product, but as you can see, like today, bring in some business knowledge to you guys as well. And one of the things I just want to share before last slide before I bring George on is I've always believed in the four critical stages to securing a client for life. And really, AutoTask helps you run your business like you're going to sell it across those four critical stages. You definitely want to start out in a consultative role in that sales process. And once you recommend those one-time solutions, those projects, whether it's a remediation engagement to get them ready for your managed services, a combination of on-prem and cloud-type solutions, whatever type project it is, you can manage it with AutoTask Project Module. Then you move into that recurring service mode, perhaps, or time and material, whatever type of support you're providing your client, all of that getting you up into that trusted advisor role. And in the SMBs, you become the IT department, and if you're moving up market to accounts with IT staff, you can supplement and augment, again, using TaskRar and various components of AutoTask. So this cycle continues on. Once you're in that trusted advisor role, you learn more needs, You see how that your business is, your client's business is evolving. And again, always trying to understand the need, recommend a solution, and then support what you put in. And as you could see, across this entire life cycle, we are going to support you every step of the way through various modules inside of Autotask. And the key, again, is you want to run your business like you're going to sell it. And to really get you into that mindset, we're going to bring on George Sergio, a partner at Cogent Growth Partners. And George, welcome to the webinar today. I think it's a fantastic topic, and looking forward to hearing what you have to say.
Thanks, Len. I appreciate it. Thanks for inviting me. And very, very happy to be here. This is a subject that's also near and dear to my heart. So let me give you a quick background of myself on why I kind of like this subject and where this material is actually coming from. So I have about 12 years behind me as being a the owner of technology solution companies. After that, I moved on to about 8 years of advising other technology solution companies in the channel, some outside the channel, but mostly in the IT world. So I know the IT world very well, near and dear to my heart there. And recently, I went from helping people prepare themselves to, you know, build the best profitability they possibly could inside the company, whatever their business model may have been, and also helping them prepare to possibly sell or buy other companies, and then actually helping with some M&A transactions with that. I actually moved over starting in January with Cogent Growth Partners as a partner, handling M&A transactions there. And Cogent, we're a buy-side M&A company, so our clients are all looking to grow by acquisition. We help them from soup to nuts, from determining criteria to buy companies that are going to achieve a certain goal, through the research, through talking to prospective acquisition candidates, all the way through the paperwork, due diligence, closing, and integration. So we're a pretty unique company, and you know, there's a lot of things involved in M&A, and this presentation is going to get a little bit into that so people have a better understanding if they're ever looking to sell their company, or even if they're looking to buy other companies, this would help out too. And if you never do, it'll also help you maximize your profitability. So my mantra has always been, run it like you're going to sell it, when I was advising companies, and I still believe in that. It's pretty important, no matter what your plans are, and when you do it like this, you know, this mindset allows you to change your mind on a regular basis. It also sets you up for some other things, and that's what we're going to go through right now. I'm going to give you a little list of what we have here. So why would you plan to sell now? Well, if you ever do want to sell, you don't want to wait till the last second. I promise you that I listen every day to people that aren't really happy with what comes across when you know, I come in there and give them a ballpark of what their company is worth after I do all my diligence on the company, because they weren't really ready for it. Now, and again, when I call them, they're not exactly ready for it anyway, because we look for companies that aren't necessarily for sale, but it would make sense to join up forces with another company. So that's even worse, as far as I'm concerned. You know, the best thing you could do is not need to sell, but be prepared to actually do it if it happens. So, you know, if you don't have goals in mind, just to run your company in general, you don't have any structure set up, there's just no way that you're going to sell your company for top dollar, whether you have to sell it, you want to sell it, or something comes across your table. Usually, if it just comes across your table and you're not prepared, you're not going to like the number. For those of you that think that you're going to purposely put your company out on the market, the rough news about that is that most companies that do go and put their business on the market don't do too well. First off, the value of the company automatically goes down just because everybody knows you're definitely looking to sell. So there's no real reason to give you any kind of premium pricing. The odds are you also weren't ready to necessarily sell. You know, you decided, well, I want to sell by the next year or two. You probably did nothing to actually prepare for it. So that gives you one long timeline to actually get these things you know, prepared, which probably won't happen, and it makes your timeline for actually finding a suitable buyer very difficult. So if you don't already set up beforehand, you're going to have a hard time. That's what the first bullet point's all about. The next thing is, it doesn't really matter. I mean, the one thing I usually did when I was talking to people about helping their companies a couple of years ago, I would ask them, what are you looking to do? what can I help you with? Do you want to build business value, or do you want to maximize profitability? And the great thing about that question is, it didn't matter what the answer was. If you run your business like you're going to sell it, you're doing both of those things at the same time. So that's the beauty of this whole thing. You can change your mind on a dime and still be in a position to do that. And the next bullet point, this is an important one. A lot of people, when I ask them, you know, what is your plan for possibly exiting your company? And a lot of them will say, well, I'm going to wait pretty much till I get an offer I can't refuse. Not a bad idea, but the odds are if you're not ready for it, you're never going to get an offer you can't refuse. I mean, right now there's a lot of M&A going on in the channel, and there will be for quite some time because of the fragmentation and the economy and a couple different factors. So a lot of people probably on this call are getting various calls every month from a variety of people that are looking into their company to possibly buy them. That doesn't necessarily mean you got on their radar for a good reason. It just might mean you're in the right geography and possibly the right size, and they're looking to see, you know, what your company is all about. So you might get an offer off of that, but I promise you, you're not going to be really happy with it if you're not in a position to command a better price tag. It's much like going to a bank. I'm sure everybody on the call can attest to the fact that the best time to try to get money from a bank is when you don't need it. Same thing when you're talking about exiting out of your company, or not necessarily exiting, but joining forces with another company as an employee or a minority shareholder or a merge or something like that, which we'll talk about in a little while, the possibilities that that you could probably come across on that kind of exit. And then the important thing a lot of people don't understand is that when you set yourself up as if you're going to sell your company at any given moment, what you're really creating is a self-made insurance policy. So what do I mean by that? Well, you know, bad things can happen to anybody, to good people. It happens all the time. It could be a divorce. It could be a partner that just wants to get out, and without that partner, you're in trouble. Or somebody in the family got sick, or you just ready to up and move because something else happened. Well, if you weren't planning on selling, obviously, something bad happened. Well, this is an insurance policy that says, well, you know, it's not good to be in a position where you have to sell, but if you are already prepared to sell, at least you have something to sell. So that's what I mean by a self-made insurance policy. Otherwise, nobody's going to want to pick you up. They know you're in panic mode, and they'll just, you know, give you a really low-ball offer, or they won't offer you anything. Just let your clients start shedding and picking them up, and there's nothing you can do about that. So I want to make sure that you're in a better position and get that self-made insurance policy. Let me give you a little factoids about selling. So I kind of mentioned it before that a lot of businesses that go out and put themselves on the market to outright sell, a lot of them actually don't sell. They don't sell because they're not liking any of the offers that come in, because their company really isn't worth much. They didn't think about it beforehand. Or the fact that, again, once you put yourself out there to sell, you have to find a buyer. And finding the right buyer is not exactly easy. And you know, there's many things that can go wrong, and what happens is people just go back to the drawing board and they don't sell, or they go out of business. So I don't want to see that to happen to anybody here. So let's prepare yourself to not have that happen. But those that do go out there and put their business on the market, like I said, it takes time. It takes a lot of time, and much more time than you think, to find a suitable buyer. And you might get a whole bunch of offers, and none of them are anywhere near what the potential of the company really should garner from a sale. So most companies that do sell, because they put it on the market, they don't sell for full value. That's just a fact. It's very rare. The ones that do sell for full value, they usually don't get much of a premium. If they do, it's a very small amount. And these, again, people that put their business on the market on purpose. But the businesses that mainly do sell for some kind of a premium value are the ones that actually were prepared to get that unsolicited offer that they couldn't refuse. That's the ones that get the premium. Because somebody saw them, they got on somebody's radar, they're in a growth by acquisition mode, or they're in a merger mode, and they want to actually do this. So you're not conjuring up a buyer, they're finding you. When they find you, you got a much better shot of getting that premium value, because you weren't the one that put it on the market. So when you maximize your profitability now for a sale later, you're actually getting yourself on people's radar, so that whenever the time comes up, you're in a I'm not a power position, but a better position to say, yes, that's a good offer that makes sense for me to move. That's what we want to do. So let's talk about a couple possible exits that do happen in this particular space. So a lot of people tell me they don't want to ever sell. They're just going to run it till they retire. That's definitely an exit. It still doesn't change the fact that you should run it like you're going to sell it because, again, that's maximizing your profitability. And if you should change your mind, you'll be able to do that. Other than that, what you're doing is trying to get your company to shed as